Manga and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Ming and Hilde Lead a Revolution, The Girls Who Changed the World, Book 3, written by Jackie French and read by Edwina Wren. To the Durga people of Yuan country, past, present and future, custodians of the land on which I live and write, in love and gratitude, J.F. To James and Dunmore, to Jack and Tom, to every person who works for good, and to the turkeys. Chapter 1. A perfectly safe adventure? The school's boarding house smelled of sweaty joggers and Kayla's genuine goat's milk shampoo. Ming Qong, traveller into the past and girl who changed the world twice, glanced through the window of the cubicle opposite her bed. But the blue light she'd thought she glimpsed shimmering above the bicycle shed had gone. That blue light might mean danger and adventure. It might be Herstory, ready to fling her back into the past again, or checking that Ming had kept her promise to write the stories of girls in the past who'd changed the world, the stories that never made it into the history books, the ones that focused on his story, on the deeds of men. Had anyone else seen the blue shimmer? She thought probably not. All the lights were out in the other cubicles too, though Ming was pretty sure Kayla was still texting under the bedclothes. Ming shivered. Ever since the last time Herstory had flung her into the past and then brought her back, she'd had a strange feeling someone or something was watching her. History's sister was probably always surveying the story of humanity, but that was different from specifically spying on her. Ming lay back and stared through the darkness at the ceiling. Not long ago, she'd been in the 1890s. She'd changed the world as she fought beside women and girls from that time who had battled for decades to slowly win more rights for women. Straight after that, she and her brother had been thrust back into World War I. She'd changed the world as a spy with more courageous girls and women. She'd been scared. She'd been hungry. She and Tuan had nearly died when the enemy blew up the house she and her brother had been hiding in. Then Herstory had brought them back to the present. Suddenly they'd been safe again. But Tuan just muttered, "Forget it," whenever Ming tried to talk to him about those weeks in the past. He had been badly injured, smuggled out of hospital and hidden in a cellar to stop his being deported as a slave worker to Germany. Ming had faced danger, but it had been adventure too. Tuan had just known darkness, pain and terror. Ming had sworn she and Tuan would fight to change their own world too, but all Tuan would say when Ming tried to talk to him about that was how they needed a good education first. Maybe during the holidays they could volunteer with protecting the endangered turtles that laid their eggs on the beach, right in the middle of the ore refinery area at Port Hedland at home. Ming rolled over, trying to find the magic position that would send you to sleep. It was hard to settle back to school routine when you'd helped to blow up a trainload of deadly gas and escaped from a tiger. On the other hand, at school she had 3 boring meals a day and was in absolutely no danger of being shot by a firing squad or buried in a dust storm. It was safe. It was also dull. How could anyone change the world stuck there in school? Ming wanted to change the world now. So far, she'd achieved a 16 out of 20 for her history project on how women had fought for the vote in Australia. 16 out of 20. She'd been there. She knew heaps more about the subject than Mr. Bores and his history books. At least she'd received 20 out of 20 for her term sustainability project, with a big red, "Good work, Ming," written on the cover page. But Miss Simler had looked startled when Ming asked if the school would use the school car park to actually try out her idea of covering the world's concrete with roofs of green vines, grapes, ivy, even kiwi fruit, to help stop global warming. What was the point of coming up with ideas to change the world if he couldn't do anything? Ming rolled back and glanced out the cubicle window again. The light was back. She sat up as the blue shimmer swirled into a glowing mist, coming closer and closer still towards the dorm. Suddenly, Herstory walked through what should have been the wall, then sat herself comfortably on the windowsill. She looked just like she had a few weeks ago, silver-haired, purple-robed, both young and very old. The world stopped. No, time has stopped, Ming thought, as Herstory grinned at her. The rustles of bedclothes, the thumps of the possum up in the school roof, the mutter of the TV from Miss Simler's room at the end of the corridor had disappeared. As always, History's sister looked both close and incredibly far away. "Bored?" asked Herstory. Ming could hear the laughter in her voice. "Yes," said Ming frankly. She'd been through too much now to fear Herstory, especially now she knew how much Herstory really cared about women and their stories. Herstory shook her head. "Most people live in a little box of the present, neither gazing back nor looking forwards. The past is a fascinating place. How can you imagine your future if you don't know the past?" Ming nodded. Despite all the history she had studied, the past had been totally different from anything she had expected. Herstory raised an eyebrow, the blue light shimmering around her. "Do you want to go back?" "To another time." There was no place for Ming now with the friends she'd made on her two previous escapades. It was sad to think she would never see Flo or Marie again, but good to know they'd led happy, fulfilled lives, and that they'd changed the world. "Could I go to a less dangerous place this time?" asked Ming tentatively. It wasn't that she was afraid exactly, but too much had happened, too fast and often violently in her other adventures. When Herstory had promised to send her to the past, she'd dreamed of being a princess in a castle who stopped an invasion, maybe even a young female pharaoh who had invented paper made from papyrus. "A safe place, too," Ming added quickly, because after all, there were crocodiles in ancient Egypt and battles with chariots and spears.
"You'd like to visit a safe, comfortable place where you can watch a girl change the world?"
Ming nodded. "Yes, please." Herstory grinned again, but there was something about this grin.
"The past is never entirely safe," Herstory said lightly. "Plus, there's no dentists, mobile phones to call for help, poverty, diseases and accidents without antibiotics."
"A lot of the world is still like that," said Ming.
"But you're lucky enough to be comfortable here. Still want to go?"
"You won't send me to a war this time? Or anywhere with tigers?"
"Definitely no wars and no tigers either. No sea monsters and no volcanoes erupting."
"Then yes," said Ming quickly, in case she chickened out. The past was enormous. Suddenly all she could think about were ancient shipwrecks and Vikings, or Saxons or Genghis Khan's hordes invading and killing everyone. Herstory held out her hand. Six blue time drops glowed even brighter than the light that shone around her.
"Close your eyes, Ming Qong," she ordered, throwing the stones so the ceiling glowed with blue light.
Ming closed her eyes quickly, clenching her fists to stop her hands trembling. She had only just survived last time. This might be the most stupid thing she had ever done. The world shifted and began to rock. Ming was sitting up, not lying on her bed. She was pretty sure she wasn't in her pajamas anymore either.
"Now, Open them.
Herstory's voice sounded infinitely far away. Ming opened her eyes and screamed. Chapter 2. The Ship. She was on a chair on a ship. A sinking ship, leaping and rolling in the waves. All Ming could see through the brass-rimmed wooden portal was a vast green wall of water flecked with foam. The ship lurched upwards again. The green portal showed blue sky for a few seconds, then met another wave. Up and down, sea and sky, the splash and clash of water. No, not sinking, Ming thought in relief. Or not yet, anyway, despite the furious sea. Maybe Herstory had kept her promise, and this adventure would be safe and comfortable. And she wasn't going to begin it cold and desperate, struggling to survive as wave mountains crashed about her. She took a breath and started to assess her surroundings. This had to be an olden days ship. She could hear the creak and flap of sails and rigging. But how far back had she come? 100 years? 1,000? There were no engine noises, and a lantern hung above a polished wooden table bolted to the floor. The chair, with its deep red silk cushions embroidered with darker red dragons, was also bolted down. A large metal chest with a rounded top and brass edging embossed with even more dragons was strapped to the wall. A silky, Persian-looking rug had been spread across the roughened wood floor, but all of those could be in many places in the past few thousand years. The bed against the wooden wall was as narrow as her bed back at school, but softer. And her doona had become a pale blue silk quilt, the fabric so rich and thick it almost looked like water flowing over the bed. Given the raging ocean outside, Ming would have preferred it to have been printed with cats, dogs, or bandicoots, land animals, and safe. The bed was presumably bolted to the floor too, as it didn't slide as the ship climbed up, 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 then flung itself downwards with another crack of rigging and timber. Ming clung on hard to the chair, wishing she was bolted to it as well. How had people dared to sail in these things for hundreds of years? One out of four ships never returned, even 150 years before her own time, she remembered. Lost forever, unless the wreckage or skeletons were found hundreds of years later. The ship wallowed back and forth for a minute, then began to climb yet another giant wave. So this is what Herstory thought was not dangerous? Ming took a deep breath of mouldy air. It smelled of salt and sweat and what she thought was probably rat from the scratching and squeaks from under the floorboards. The ship isn't going to sink, she told herself. Herstory had promised she'd be safe. Ming just had to hold on and work out when she was, where she was, who she was, and how she was supposed to help change the world this time. Okay. Who was she? She looked down. A white, tight-waisted silk dress glinted in the green-shadowed light from the porthole, showing a faint embossing of flowers somehow woven into the richness of the fabric, with buttoned lace cuffs and buttoned white boots. Her fingers found a rounded collar of delicate white lace. She felt her ears and discovered she wore small pearl earrings. Dad would have a fit if she returned with pierced ears. She wasn't allowed piercings till she was 16. Hopefully the holes would vanish when she got back. A white nightdress lay at the end of the bed, thick cotton this time, trimmed with ruffles, which were then trimmed with even more lace. The nightdress and her white silk dress were beautiful. They also smelled of salt and sweat too, though not as strongly as the cabin, plus a lot of lavender that didn't quite cover up the other smells. The dress was hideously uncomfortable as well. Ming thought wistfully about the comfort of her school uniform. At least it allowed her to move easily. The undergarments she wore now not only squashed her chest flat, but were thick and starched as hard as a board, making it impossible to bend at the waist, so she had to sit stiffly erect. There had to be at least 2 petticoats under the dress, and no underpants. Aha, that was a clue. The dress seemed early to mid-1800s.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.